My grandfather was a great warrior. He was a highly renowned king and founder of probably the world's greatest empire. But he was not even of royal lineage, which is why I probably admired him very much, maybe even more than I did my own father. And my grandfather reciprocated by doting on me equally. For I was exceptional in intelligence and warrior skills. I was regarded to be haughty and even rude. My name literally means the one without sorrows. But I was adept at giving much pain to others. Such was my valor and strength that I could kill a lion with my bare hands. My friends and my enemies considered me to be a heartless man, but this is something which I didn't even care denying. Consequently, the day my grandfather threw down his sword and left us all alone in the pursuit of peace and solitude, I was very surprised. I picked up his sword and took a vow to carry forward his legacy and empire. But little did I then realize that the same questions which had confronted my grandfather would confront me also in years to come, and that I too would undergo the same transformation. But for now, I was happy slitting the throats of any contender to the throne, which was soon to be vacated by my father. However, not being the eldest in the family and having a dozen brothers did not make the task any easier. My eldest brother even tried to dispatch me from the kingdom to quell a rebellion he had raked up himself. But my mere presence was enough to satisfy the rebelling parties, and the rebellion ended without any conflict. Soon, I married the daughter of a monk and became the governor of a nearby province. A little later, my own father passed away. But it is here that my brother did the unthinkable. He attempted to execute my whole family, including my unborn child. And he succeeded. He killed my unborn child. I was in a fit of unimaginable rage. I was in such fury that I killed all my brothers and dumped them in a well. I had become the sole heir to my grandfather's legacy. I had become the emperor of the greatest empire in India. My lust for conquest saw the kingdom's boundary go beyond seams in all directions. But there was one little kingdom that was eluding me. This kingdom claimed to be a democratic one, meaning the king was not really a king, but a servant of his own people. What a pathetic idea. I laid siege on the capital city for days and months and years, and finally conquered the kingdom, but at the expense of more than 100,000 lives. One fine evening, as I was taking a stroll in the city, taking stock of the massacre, all I could see was burnt houses and scattered corpses. A surge of remorse passed through my body. I stuttered, and said to myself, is this victory or is this defeat? What have I done? Is it valor, is it strength to kill innocent women and children? Do I do this to expand my territories or to burn the neighbors to ashes? This is not victory. This is not victory. Dear guests, the brief story and the final words that you heard now belong to that of the greatest emperor of India, probably even that of the world, the Priyadarshin, the Maurya Raja, Samrat Ashok of the Maurya Empire. What happened next is relatively common knowledge. Ashoka embraced Buddhism and saw to it that he propagates this new religion throughout Asia. He built monuments in the memory depicting the life of Gautam Buddha. He embraced concepts like truth, tolerance, love, ahimsa, and even vegetarianism. He built universities. He promoted trade and agriculture, and he made allies, friends out of his neighbors and not enemies. Renowned British historian H.G. Wells, in his 1920 book titled The Outline of History, said, and I quote, "The world has seen many great warriors and kings who shone in the sky for a while but eventually flickered away. But Samrat Ashoka shines like that big bright star even until today." The significance of King Ashoka to us Indians is deep and reverent. The Ashok Chakra at the center of the national flag, or the lion pillar, which finds a place in many symbols of India, including the currency coins, reminds us constantly of the importance that us Indians have bestowed upon this great king. But it is often we forget what is close to us, what is good, and hence what is important. So next time you believe that imperfection is acceptable, or you feel that change is difficult, you believe it is difficult to transform, and you are searching for the role model, then think of that bright shining light, the King Ashoka sitting on the throne of peace and humanity.